Hi guys, John here. Good to see you. Even though I'm not seeing you, it's good to see you. I hope you see us. And we're looking forward to just spending a few brief moments with you with respect to the low back and the mature or the aging back or the elderly back or whatever you want to call it. So I'm here with my friend Spencer, and Spencer's going to be taking a few moments just to go over some of the anatomy of the low back, because it's the anatomy that helps drive what we kind of do with an aging back. And then after he's done with that, I'm going to come in and I'm just going to talk briefly about some things we commonly see with the aging back. Then I'm going to give you a few exercises that are pretty universal when it comes to dealing with the mature back. So with that in mind, I'm going to hand it over to my friend Spencer, and he's going to tell you about the anatomy of the
lower back. So I'm Spencer. I'm a student on a clinical rotation here with John at Orthopedic and Spine Therapy. I'm just going to briefly talk about the anatomy of the low back so that John can then build on that and talk about some different things that could go wrong and what we can do to fix them. So when we talk about the low back, it's really just these five vertebrae right here. They have a natural curve to them just to help support the weight and distribute the forces a little bit in our back. And they gradually get bigger as they go down as well. In between each of our vertebrae, we have these discs. These discs are kind of like ligaments, and they're filled with like this jelly-like substance that just helps with some shock absorption and further distributing some of those forces. We have four different, what we call facet joints for each of these vertebrae. They just connect each vertebrae to the one above it and the one below it. John will talk about how these can get a little bit restricted and locked down and cause some discomfort as well. Then we have the nerves running out in between each of these from our spinal cord. The first three nerves coming out of our low back are really going to be more the front of our leg, and then the bottom ones, and then down into our sacrum, those nerves are going to feed the back of our leg, and these run all the way down our foot and into our toes. So there's some pretty long nerves. The spaces that the nerves come out of, these can get narrowed, and John will talk about that and how this can cause some compression of the nerves and cause some different symptoms down the leg, like you might have heard of, like sciatica or something like that. So that pretty much covers the basic anatomy of the low back, and then John can build on some of that.
It's me again. Welcome back. And again, you can see me, I can't see you, but I hope you're all out there, and I hope you're all doing well, especially with your back. Now, Spencer did a great job talking about the anatomy of the back. Now, what I want to talk about is just a back that is aging. Now, I'm 64 years old, I have an aging back, and I would assume that many of you are more than 64 years old, so your back is probably aging more than mine. But some common things that happen with an aging back. Number one, Spencer talked about the discs, these kind of cushiony areas in between the vertebra that are bone. Now what happens with the disc as a back age is the disc, which is about, probably 80 to 90% water or fluid, starts to dry up. And as these discs here dry up, the space between the vertebra where the disc is becomes narrow, okay? That can cause some problems. Because as the disc dries up and the bones get closer to each other, a number of things happen. Number one, Spencer talked about these facet joints here. Well, those facet joints, as the bones get closer, start to grind. The bone ends grind on each other, and these joints become, here's our word for the day, arthritic. And I know many of you, maybe all of you, have arthritis. In fact, 80% of all 18-year-olds, not 80-year-olds, 80% of all 18-year-olds have arthritis at these joints. So it shows you how early it starts to form. So that's one problem. Number two, Spencer also talked about these openings where the nerves come out here, here, all the way down. Well, as the bones get closer together, as the disc dries up, not only do the joints become arthritic, but the opening where the nerves come out become narrow. And the word for that is stenosis. And it's one of the most common things we see in an aging back. So commonly, as a back ages, a number of things happen. The bones get closer together. The joints here, the facet joints, become arthritic. The opening where the nerve comes out becomes more narrow, and it becomes stenosis. And as it becomes stenotic or narrow, it tends to impinge or compress or irritate the nerves that go down the legs. Henceforth, you may get this sciatic pain or this leg pain or this tingling or this numbness that goes down the leg because of that issue. Okay? So that's just some of the degenerative cascade we see with an aging back. So what do people do? What do you do when these types of changes start to set in? Well, one of the most common things we see people as they age do with their low back is their low back, as Spencer has talked about, this nice curve here. As people age, that low back, that curve starts to become flat and straight. Okay? In other words, that nice curve you're looking at from the side starts to flatten out. And people, and maybe some of you, start to lean forward a little bit. Why do you lean forward? Number one, as you lean forward, the openings get wider. And number two, as you lean forward, you have less compressive force on those facet joints. So you find that leaning forward helps many times your low back feel better as you age. So you see people walking around bent forward, hunched forward, those type of things. And many times people will say, when I'm sitting down, I feel good. If I stand, if I walk for too long a period of time, I start to get increased pain. My leg starts to hurt. Well, that's all part of this degenerative process as we get older, okay? So the most common things we see with an aging back are stenosis, facet joint arthritis, and degenerative disc disease, okay? So with that said, what in the world do you do with these things? Is there anything you can do? Well, if things get too bad, sometimes they have to do a surgery and remove some of the bone called a laminectomy to open up where the nerves come out. But hopefully you don't get to that point. Maybe some of you have had that surgery, okay? And that's okay if you need that, but there are a lot of things you can do short of having that surgery. And we find a number of things can be helpful, okay? One thing we recommend functionally as a functional exercise for people with this type of case scenario is if you're going to be exercising, we recommend a lot of exercises are done in sitting, okay? Because in sitting, again, you're unloading the facet joints, and in sitting, you're opening up where the nerves come out. So a lot of sitting exercise, stationary biking, maybe a rowing machine, maybe a leaning forward type exercise, a stretching forward exercise, because those really help deal with the problems that are causing you pain. So sitting exercise, good. Number two, one of the best things you can do if you want to walk, if you want to stand and do exercise, is walking in a swimming pool. Because walking in a swimming pool helps this, with the buoyancy, helps decompress some of this tissue. I know a 90-year-old woman that walks about 3 miles in a swimming pool every day, and she feels good. She can't do that out of a swimming pool, but in a swimming pool, she's able to walk that distance, and she loves that exercise. So it may be something you consider doing if you want to continue to do upright exercise, functional exercise. Sitting exercises, stationary bike, walking in the pool, some of the best stuff you can do with an aging back, okay? Now that said, there are also a couple mechanical things that we recommend to people to do with an aging back. And I could give you a book of 800 exercises to do, but I know you're not going to do 800 exercises. So what I'm going to recommend to you probably are two or three things that we like to do with an aging back, okay? And one of the things I like to do in a sitting position is just kind of a movement that's going to arch the back a little bit and then slump the back a little bit. Arch the back a little bit, slump the back a little bit. And we want to do these in a pain-free range. We call it translation. And I think I'm going to demonstrate as best as I can on Spencer. So Spencer, if you don't mind, I'm going to have you sit. Why don't you sit right on the pillow facing that way? That should hold you. If it doesn't, you'll be the first one to know. We're going to basically translate his back forward. The way to do that is he just arches his back and then slump. Just like that. Translation. And you want to do this within a pain-free range of motion, because you don't want to slam it into a painful range, because that can cause increased inflammation in those joints. So translation in a pain-free range in a sitting position is great. It does a number of things. It stretches muscle. It opens and closes those facet joints. And movement is important to nourish the tissue. So just like that. And I'll have people do 10 to 12 of these at a time. Sometimes before you, on the side of a bed before you get up in the morning. That's a great thing. But I recommend you do it in sitting, because again, with an aging back, sitting is probably the preferable position to do a lot of your exercises in. So translation is good, okay? Another thing that we recommend to people is, let's have you scoot back on a little bit. Is remember what I said, and that is, as these openings where the nerves come out become narrow, become stenotic, these nerves can actually become impinged or bound down in that opening. And when that happens, you start getting some leg pain, you start getting some butt pain, you might get some numbness, tingling, burning, all the way down to the bottom of a foot sometimes. So what we want to do is help mobilize the nerve through that opening, all right? It's a very simple exercise. Now, the reason we want to mobilize those nerves is to keep them from getting bound down. And nerves, here's a general rule, nerves like to be stretched. They don't like to be compressed. So if we don't stretch them out, they're going to become compressed and cause you more problems. So the way to mobilize the nerve, you can actually do it right through the leg. So I'm going to come back to Spencer here, okay? So when he's sitting, if he wants to mobilize and work the nerves on the left side, all he's got to do in a sitting position is straighten the left knee to the point where he's going to feel a little pull and then back off. And try it again. So when you work that, I have people do 5 to 10 repetitions up, down, up, down, up, down. Okay, and what that does is, because the nerves go down the leg, it works the nerve through that opening. It's incredible how much motion occurs at the spine when he's bending and straightening his knee. How do I know it? I've seen it. I've seen it on fresh cadavers. There's a huge amount of motion occurs. So one of the things I recommend for people as they age is this exercise, because you really want to prevent this nerve from getting pinched, from getting bound down. You want to keep it mobile, because if you can keep it mobile, you can really help, especially the leg symptoms. All right? One more stretching. Okay. So one of the things we many times see in an aging individual, not only does the back get stiff, not only does stenosis set in, not only does arthritis set in, well, the same thing tends to happen with the hip joints. And one of the stretches I like giving to people, if they can tolerate it, which encompasses the nerve, which encompasses the low back joints, but also brings into focus the hip joint, is this stretch. I'll have them bend the knee up. If they can, turn it this way. Now, can you grab hold of your knee and ankle? And holding it turned that way, just gently pull it to the opposite shoulder to the point where you feel a pull. Could be in the butt, could be in the back, could be in the knee. Wherever you first feel the pull, take it to that point and back off. 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 That's a great stretch. It encompasses all that tissue, the hip, the low back, the nerve, everything. Two times you wouldn't want to use that. Number one is if when you're doing this stretch, you feel symptoms into the groin, like there's a pinching. You got to back off then. You don't want to create that pinching. Number two, if you've had a total hip procedure surgically done where the approach was through the back or through the outside. There are different approaches to surgery for total hip. If it was a total hip where the procedure was done in the back, you don't want to go past 90 degrees with that. If you've had a total hip with an anterior or front approach, you can go as far as you want with it. So that would be two case scenarios. So sum up exercise, sum up things you want to do with an aging back. Number one, walking in a pool. Exercises in a pool are great. And also sitting exercise, such as stationary bike, possibly rowing, things like that. And then these three stretches. One is just for translation, forward and backward for the joints of the back. Number two is straightening the knee when you're sitting because it works the nerve. And number three is the exercise I just showed you works the low back, it works the nerve, it works the muscle, works the back of the hip joint. So there are three things you can try to do. And once again, as always, if you're having issues that aren't resolving, we would love to see you for one of our free screens and hopefully direct you appropriately based on what you show us. We'd love to see you here in Hortonville or any of our clinics in the Fox Cities, whether it's Appleton, whether it's Kaukauna, whether it's Menasha, whether it's Oshkosh, whether it's here, any of those places would be just fine. Take advantage of the free screen. So hopefully, even though we can't interact and have a Q&A like we usually do, which we love to do, which I love doing with you guys because you guys are a ball when we come, and I miss that, at least we've given you some insight into dealing with the aging back, the maturing back, the degenerative back, whatever you want to call it, and giving you some direction with some general exercises you can do and general functional activities you can try. So hopefully that does it for you. It does it for us. You guys are delightful. Can't wait till we see you again. And we'll carry on our Q&A sessions. And blessings to you all.